Bun găsit la dezbaterile Meet Your Map. Astăzi avem un invitat special de la Comisia Europeană, pe domnul Gheorghi Dimitrov, șef de unitate Digital Education în cadrul Directoratului General Educație și Cultură al Comisiei Europene, și pe domnul Victor Negrescu, europarlamentar, care tocmai a avut ieri un raport important în Parlamentul European despre digitalizarea educației. Acum vom schimba în limba engleză. We'll switch to English. Hello, Mr. Negrescu. Hello, Mr. Dimitrov. Thank you for this intervention. First of all, this COVID pandemic period of 1 year so far has shown us how much we need to digitize education and also to educate ourselves in digital skills. How do you think our EU countries have managed to adapt to online schooling? Mr. Dimitrov, please.
Many thanks, Claudiu. Many thanks to Hot News for this invitation. And allow me, please, to start with congratulating Mr. Negrescu for a very important achievement. I'm sure he will say something about it, but I would like to congratulate Mr. Negrescu for the adoption of the report on digital education yesterday in the Parliament. Big kudos to you, Mr. Negrescu, as a rapporteur. To your question, it is clear that in the last year, 2020, we have witnessed a very sharp move to online learning, and in the European Union, around 100 million learners, students and pupils have been affected. We have tried across the member states to contain the spread of the virus, and education and training institutions in the large majority of the European Union have suspended in-person instruction and have moved to what you referred to, online learning, distance learning, but also using other platforms, television, radio, and other channels. What we have experienced is rather emergency online learning and teaching and not full digital education. This sudden shift to distance learning has been not simple, and it has been actually very, very difficult for many. And I believe it has shown very clearly a few things. One is we have a lot of inequalities in the European Union. And we had them also before the crisis, but we have seen their magnitude. We have never thought that we are perhaps lagging so much behind in questions such as access to internet, how fast the internet connection is, how many pupils have access to internet. And I believe that this is a first very important issue which prevented this online and distance learning to be fully effective. It has something to do directly with the level of preparedness of our education and training systems. And we saw that infrastructure, connectivity, devices, computers and tablets, but also online education content, the capability of the schools and the universities to move, and the teachers' skills. Really, the teachers are so important, and their confidence and skills levels are critical in order to enable this online and distance learning. And we have seen across the EU plenty of gaps. We have to nevertheless recognize that the governments, and I am aware of many efforts in the different member states, have done a lot of work, and teachers, parents and learners have been innovating, and we have to recognize this effort. 1 year after COVID, because we are just 1 year later, it is very, very important to also see that we are now much more, if you like, efficiently dealing with online and distance learning. We know better where the problems are. And currently, many member states have their schools in a hybrid mode. So it functions better than 1 year ago. But I think that it is not perfect. And the last point that I would like to make to this question is that all of this experience is something that we have analyzed carefully and put into the Digital Education Action Plan that the European Commission adopted last September. And there we have identified two long-term strategic priorities, which I believe will lead us over the next 5 to 6 years. And they are, on the one side, the need to develop what we call a high-performing digital education ecosystem and to cover access, connectivity, devices, teacher skills, the capabilities of schools. But on the other side, to constantly support pupils and the population to develop their digital skills and competences. This is why we are very, very happy to see also the great level of support in the report of the European Parliament, which was adopted yesterday. Many thanks.
As you said, the European Union, the European countries are better prepared right now after 1 year of this pandemic period. But these days, our government in Romania just extended the holidays for pupils because of this pandemic situation. So, Mr. Negrescu, tell us your opinion about these developments and about the your report that Mr. Dimitrov mentioned.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the invitation. And I'm really happy to have this debate on digital education here at HONEWS. And indeed, of course, digitizing our education system is a huge challenge. And of course, means that we have to invest more in education to manage to do it, but also to involve all the relevant stakeholders in the process. We need to involve teachers, we need to involve students, we need to involve parents that played a huge role during the pandemic. We need to involve the local communities, NGOs, social partners, the private sector in the process in order for this to be a success. What has unfortunately happened in many countries is that we switch to online education without actually preparing for it. And we supposed that by giving a tablet or a computer to a child, this meant digitizing our education system. But this is not digital education. Digital education means specific methods, means a quality infrastructure, means adequate resources, adequate content, and again, an educational platform. So if I refer precisely again to Romania, unfortunately, almost 1 million kids couldn't get access to education because, again, when digitizing, the Romanian state has forgotten about them. So, of course, they were left without any access to education. And of course, this led and still leads to a lot of issues and a lot of problems. And of course, probably a lot of them are going to leave school for forever because of that. So in our report in the European Parliament, we try to address this issue. We speak about the inequality existing at European level. We speak about how we can merge together the different financial tools to support education and digitizing education. We speak about the need to allocate at least 10% of the recovery and resilience funds for education. We define what we mean by quality digital education. And we offer a couple of solutions to do that, of course, as fast as possible, to tackle the current situation, to actually find solution for the current third wave, for which, in my opinion, we are not prepared at European level. We are doing better maybe than last year. But yeah, in many countries, we still have difficulties. And again, this choice of giving extending the holiday, in my opinion, is a signal that, of course, in the case of Romania, we were not prepared for that. It's basically, we don't want to recognize that we didn't do enough for digitizing education, and only prefer giving a holiday. Of course, if I would be to refer to digital education, I have to mention that data has shown us that indeed digital education implies, of course, an important effort to train professors. And this will be, I think, the most important remark and the most important issue that we have to refer to. How can we involve professors in the process? How we can train them adequately in order to develop these new methods and use digital education in a useful way for them? And I will finish by saying that online education, digital education, new technologies, I'm not here to replace teachers. Teachers have a huge role, a very important role in the education process. But they can indeed, those tools, those new technologies, can indeed help the teachers improve their educational practices, can improve the quality of education, if of course they are used wisely, if of course we have the right technologies adapted for each type of education. So this is what we are referring in our report. We have a lot of new initiatives that we are presenting again to European decision makers. We are supporting some that have been launched by the European Commission and especially the European Union Digital Education Action Plan. And we try, of course, to unite our energies, our forces, because in front of this pandemic, it is clear that we need a common answer at European level. And no one should be left behind, of course. A child in Romania should have the same rights, same opportunities as a child in France. A child in Denmark has to have the same opportunity as someone in Greece. So, of course, if we understand that, I'm certain that we can find the right solution and we can tackle this issue while at the same time preparing for the future of education.
Mr. Negrescu, your report is an appeal to the national governments in the EU. For example, in Romania, what kind of effect should this appeal have on the Romanian government? Is this a true effect or is more like a political declaration?
I think we are offering clear solutions. So we campaign a lot, and the draft report that just got approved was the first official European document where we had this reference about the need to allocate at least 10% of the recovery and resilience facility for education. And we pressured the government, and now we have the 10% in the plan. We hope that we'll keep it till the end. But also we need to use the other European funds in an adequate way to support this digitalization. And of course, there are a couple of projects that have already been put into place a couple of years ago that have been freezed and that have to continue. We have the project CRED, we have the project with the virtual library, we have a couple of very interesting projects, we have a fund allocated from the World Bank, and we have to use those funds, while at the same time using the new Erasmus program. And the Commission has recently launched the new Erasmus Plus in the new MFF context. We have 28 billion euros at European level, some of which are allocated for Romania, some of which imply competitions at European level. We have to support schools, professors, NGOs willing to participate in those calls and come up with very strong applications. But we also need to develop a plan and a concrete steps. For the time being in Romania, we have a national strategy, which in my opinion is not good at all because it doesn't lay down the steps for how much money we need for it. And of course, we don't have something that other countries have. We don't have an educational platform. So we use free available platforms that are given by different private companies. And I want to praise them for helping us. But we should have our own national platform. So it's more than a year since the pandemic has started. We could have, of course, developed those tools, provide adequate resources to professors that they can use online, adapt the curriculum. We could have made digital education as a useful and a successful method when in-person learning is not possible. Of course, I prefer in-person learning. I think this is the best solution. But at the same time, when this is not possible, digital education should be an accessible way of continuing educational processes. And I really believe that the government, and I hope that the government will read the report very carefully and implement what we have there, because there are European solutions implemented across Europe, and this might be really easy for Romania to do so as well.
But Mr. Negrescu, the government, can it, let's say, ignore your report?
The government can ignore everything, of course, can ignore European documents as well. So, for instance, when they developed the Romanian strategy for digital education, they forgot about the Commission European Union Digital Education Action Plan or the European Education Area. So, yeah, they are ignoring the Commission, not only the European Parliament, unfortunately. And this is why we are, I think, among the last ones in terms of digitizing our educational system. So we are lacking behind, we're staying behind, and the only alternative is, again, like you said as well, to give bigger holidays instead of doing something else. And in the same time, in the places where we impose quarantine and lockdowns, I noticed that, of course, also there we are not sure that that kids have access to education through digital means. What we are coming with very importantly in the document, and I hope that the Commission will support us on this. We had a lot of discussion, is to integrate better education in the national report done by the Commission through the European Semester Framework. And we want a special reference to digital education there. I know that here, I think this, together with the Commission, we can work on that, because once we have those references there, any government in Europe cannot ignore what they need to do in order to improve the statistics, improve access to digital education, and develop quality digital education. So I think this will be a very useful framework, again, to push any governments, not only the Romanian one, to comply with the solutions available at European level and respect the recommendations that are at the end useful for teachers, for children, for parents, for everyone. So those recommendations are there to help. They are not there to replace what is happening. They are not there to change what is happening. Government and national member states have the competence to decide on education. But at the end, yeah, they should also listen to best practices implemented at European level and the recommendation addressed by European institutions.
Mr. Dimitrov, you already mentioned the big differences between our regions and our countries in the EU. But how big are these differences from one country to another and within each EU country between our regions in terms of success of digital adaptation to the pandemic education?
This is a very difficult and good question at the same time. So in the Digital Education Action Plan, we have developed a staff working document with a lot of data and evidence around the situation across the member states. We are in the context of subsidiarity, which is essentially meaning that the national authorities are responsible for their member states. So there is not that many data points where we can, if you like, exert specific control. However, what is very clear is that when it comes to issues such as infrastructure, connectivity, level of digital skills of pupils, but also of teachers, there are very significant differences across the European Union. And I can quote one example here that even though the differences are very, very significant, by and large, the majority of the teachers, for example, through the crisis, have told us in our open public consultation on the Digital Education Action Plan, the majority being 60% or something like this, that they really do not think that the education systems are prepared for using digital technology in education and training. And I think that if you look at member states very specifically, then you see, for example, that in terms of internet access, let's take one example, Mr. Negrescu stressed access. It is very important. We see differences between 99% in the one extreme to 62% on the other side, which is the internet access in households in member states. Well, this is quite a significant difference, as you can tell. And also, we know that 6% in EU households, this is on average, where dependent children live, which, for example, right now need to access education, do not have access to even one computer. We do not have the data on how each member state is faring against this specific data point. But if you correlate this example, that 6% of all EU households do not have access to a computer, and you take also the other example, which I mentioned, that in one case we have 99% access to internet, and then in the other extreme, 62, you can easily understand that we have member states that have significant gaps and deficiencies. So This is very, very important because one thing which is fundamental is that without access, there is no digital education, no matter how effective it is. So what Mr. Negrescu stressed here in terms of access, I can only reiterate. And in fact, I would like to mention that just 3 weeks ago, the European Commission published the Digital Compass, which is the vision, if you like, for the digital transformation until 2030, which is a digital transformation in the society, not only in education. But there is one very important element there, which is called universal digital education. And this is the long term that we should be aiming for. This should be a universal access, just like an access to health services. This access should be provided also in digital education. And for this, investment is absolutely critical. The resilience and recovery plans have been mentioned, and I can only support the request of the European Parliament for the investment of 10% of the resilience and recovery plans in education. I can also tell here that from initial experience with the resilience and recovery plans of the member states, which are currently being sent to the European Commission, we see a very high priority on digital education. If anything, it is perhaps the most important item across the education investments. However, I need to also say that we are still working closely on focusing the investment, on linking investment to reform, because sometimes an investment without a reform effort is not as effective as it could be if, for example, you upgrade the digital infrastructure of the education and training system of a member state, but you, in a way, forget perhaps to include the teachers in this and to also develop their skills. So you need to, in a way, think about this holistically. This is why we are also supporting the approach of the European Parliament as expressed in the report, because it takes an integrated, a holistic approach to digital education. And in fact, it addresses the needs of the society today, which are, of course, driven by a crisis. However, the long-term digital transformation is also accelerating as we speak here. And once COVID perhaps is over, the digital transformation will continue to accelerate with impact on jobs, on society, and also on teaching and on education. So to maybe finalize on your question, the differences are great. COVID has magnified our glass to identify those differences. And now we need to work together closely with the member states, first and foremost through the resilience and recovery plans, to really focus the investment where it is needed. It is not one size fits all, and the national authorities, of course, have the competence to be responsible to focus the investments where they matter most. And this is where, of course, the member states are in the driving seat. Thank you.
So, Mr. Negrescu, do you see this holistic approach in our educational system, including the teaching of the teachers in Romania in digital skills that Mr. Dimitrov mentioned? Do you see any holistic approach?
Unfortunately, there is no real partnership with professors, but also with students and parents on this. And we noticed something, of course, when looking at Romanian document, especially within the recovery and resilience facility. And we noticed that there is no real reform, no real modernization of the education process. So for instance, there is a small project on digitizing education, but we don't have the target to create a digital education platform. And we don't speak at all about training professors. So how do you want to digitize the education system without training professors adequately, of course, to develop new methods? Is not when we mean training professors, we don't mean simply, you know, to teach them how to use a computer, but to help them and work with them in developing content and using resources that can be actively applied in a digital environment. And I'm speaking not only as a rapporteur on shaping a digital education policy at European level. I'm speaking as a professor myself, and I know very well how difficult it is to adapt and to change your classes and your methods in the online environment. So I think this is a key element. I think the starting point, and Mr. Dimitrov said that very well, is to really assess where you are right now as a country at European level, which type of technologies you use, what is the level of training of professors, if you manage to have a good connection to digital platforms, if you manage to have again an impact using online education. But we don't have this assessment in the case of Romania, so we ignore the issue when we send the documents and reports to European institutions. But we only say everything is fine. But yeah, like I said at the beginning, yeah, by simply giving a tablet, a low quality tablet, to a child, this is not digital education. Digital education is more than that. And I perfectly understand why some people across Europe, but also in Romania, didn't like this online transformation of education, because what they saw was of a low quality. But I'm telling them here, what has happened is doesn't have anything to do, again, with quality standards in the field. So this is why in the report, and here we have the support also of the Commission, and we're working closely on that, we speak about digital skill certificates at European level. Our call is also to have specific certificates for teacher training on digital skills. We speak about the need to assess the level of digitization of schools. And you have a very interesting format that the Commission is supporting. It's called the Selfie program. We want to enlarge that. Basically, each school, each professor can self-evaluate its level of digitization, so which is great. And I think this should be implemented, especially in countries like Romania, where we don't have any methods of evaluating that. In the same time, I think we should have to be courageous and come up with new initiatives. So I'm a strong supporter of coming up with a new initiative at European level, financed from European funds, but also national funds to support artificial intelligence and robotics classes. I think this is a key skill to have in the future. But we also need to improve ICT education. For instance, in Romania, we are teaching programs that are not used anymore by people working in the digital sector. So how do you want to prepare the next generation of ICT experts if you teach them to use programs that are overdated? So this is key, in my opinion. But like I said, at European level, there is a framework enabling us to do so. So there is a platform where teachers can exchange between themselves different informations. The Commission is providing reports on what is happening across Europe, but we need to use them. This will be, I think, the thing that disturbs me the most, actually, when it comes to digital education in Romania. Worries me in the same time, but I'm also really angry because of that, because we ignore those potential solutions. Our solution is always to say, this is impossible in Romania, we cannot do it, it costs too much, but today we have the money for it, we have the resources, we have the solutions, we have the opportunity, but we are not using that. And unfortunately, this will cost us on the long term, because like we underline in our report as well, in the European Parliament, the fact that kids are not having access to education, the fact that learners from different age groups are having access to low quality digital education, this will have an impact on their capacity to integrate the labor market, in their capacity to be productive in the future, and of course this will lead to lower economic results in a couple of years that will cost everyone. So what we're doing right now will have an impact in the years to come, and of course if we have to come up with a solution right now, and why not implement in the same time European recommendations.
So Mr. Negrescu mentioned the tablets that the government in Romania provided to our pupils. Across Europe, governments have taken steps to provide pupils tablet PCs for online schooling as much as possible. European funds are used in Romania also. How effective have these measures been so far, and what is still missing in an effective educational process, Mr. Dimitrov?
Indeed, some countries have provided tablets and personal computers. These are, for example, not only Romania, but Belgium, France, Croatia, Bulgaria, which I know quite well. And this is something which is, of course, excuse me, just one part of the whole solution. What is very important is to accompany the distribution of devices with the appropriate connectivity and the infrastructure that they are, of course, going to be building on. And the infrastructure includes content, high quality digital education content. The best device will not help if there is nothing to be displayed or used on the device. And of course, secondly, a key instrument is the teacher. The teacher skills development, of course, cannot happen in a crash course and as fast as a device may be distributed. So I think that this is something which we are observing, and we are also advising the member states that in all the reforms that they have, especially when it comes to the distributions of devices and tablets and computers, it is critical to support the schools, the digital leadership, if you like, and the vision in the schools, and the professional development of teachers. Mr. Negrescu mentioned already the Selfie for Teachers tool, which is going to be launched later this year, and which is building already on a quite successful tool for schools generally, which is called Selfie, about the, assessing their own digital capacity, capabilities. A very important snapshot to understand, to help you understand as a school where you are, and to be able to improve also on your weaknesses. We are going to launch Selfie for Tools based on the same philosophy, but targeted at teachers, because I believe we all agree that the teachers are the critical factor between the devices, no matter how good they are, and sometimes they are not good as well. So that's also a little bit of a problem. And then on the other side, the sound, effective pedagogical education process. We all agree that we do not want to put children behind screens, but we would like to help them to effectively learn. In addition to the self instrument, I would really like to mention that yesterday the Commission has adopted the Erasmus program, which with the support of the Parliament has become even bigger than in the past. One of the few programs that have grown in terms of budget, and we have been working extremely well with the Parliament on this. Yesterday, the Commission has launched the first call for Erasmus, and I'm mentioning this because there is one very important action that I would like to draw the attention of you, of the audience, and of everyone who works towards improving education and training organizations in the digital age. In the Erasmus call, we're going to support cooperation projects between all type of education institutions, and this includes schools and universities, but also vocational and educational training institutions, to develop what we call digital transformation plans. What is this? This is essentially the attempt of the institution, of a school, of a university, to create a clear systematic plan of strengths, weaknesses, and objectives, and to work systematically through those over the next few years to improve in a very focused way the digital capabilities. And they are very complex. We are very much aware of this. But with Erasmus, for the very first time, we will support the digital transformation plans of all type of education and training institutions, which is instrumental, because we need to realize that the school is also an organization. There is a lot of things that happen there. And the teachers have opinions, the headmaster have opinion, but there needs to be a common vision and strategy. And with Erasmus, we will now support this type of development. As I mentioned yesterday, the call went out, and you are very welcome to share also this news, because this is the type of process which Mr. Negrescu identified as competitive. So there we will have also the opportunity to apply and to compete. And it is very important that we raise the awareness in the community, especially in some of the member states. And I know that this could be sometimes quite difficult. And maybe last point to add on the tablet issue. I think the tablet issue can never be a solution in itself, and it needs to be accompanied by also proper digital skills and competences of the people who are using it, the pupils. We sometimes speak about digital natives and the children that we have. I have a 10-year-old, and we speak as if they can do everything because they can scroll so nice and so fast. The reality is that while they may be very proficient in this, they do not really understand what is behind in the digital world. They do not understand that algorithms are designed to keep their attention, for example, on TikTok, and they go on for hours and hours and hours. It is important to also better educate our pupils and students, for example, through stronger computer science, informatics education, and Romania is actually one of the countries which does this well. In some of the Eastern European countries, we have a very strong tradition in this. We need to build on this, but we need to also instill it in the schools, because we need to make sure that our children can confidently, but also responsibly, use these type of devices and also understand what they are actually meant to provide. So the tablet question requires the teacher skills, requires a strategy of the school, but it requires also the pupils to be confident and responsible users of this. And I think this would be my answer to your question. Thank you.
Mr. Dimitrov, you mentioned the selfie program. What exactly is this program about? It would be some kind of website or portal?
Yes, currently we have the selfie for schools, which has already 850,000 users. These are primarily pupils and teachers. And the tool is essentially a self-assessment online, completely free of charge, available in all European languages, and very modular in the sense that it can be even customized to the school. If you are, for example, working in a vocational educational training, it might be a little bit different than if you are in a gymnasium, in a high school. So this tool is available today, free of charge, can be integrated in the school of the member state. And we are very happy to provide you in Romania with support, if you like, on how to do that, because we have already several member states which have a couple of hundreds of thousands users. But we are very happy to help Romania with experimenting with the selfie tool for schools. In addition to it, what will come in autumn is the selfie for teachers, which is a new tool, very much building on the same philosophy, but strictly assessing the skills of the teachers only. While the first tool, the selfie, the general one, looks at the infrastructure in the school, the skills of the pupils, more general, if you like, questions. And the second one, for the teachers, will assess the digital skills of teachers and identify the needs that they have in order to continue their professional development. It will be also available in all languages. It will be free of charge, and it also will be modular, meaning that if you wish to slightly adapt some questions, maybe include some questions for your country, then you are actually able to do that from an IT point of view without any further, you don't need to be a programmer. So it's basically an interface that you can use. So these are the two parts of selfie that I can mention.
At the end of our debate here at Meet Your Map, I would like to ask you both what lessons has been learned so far at the European level and the national level, and what solutions do we have on the table?
So who do you want to start? I will start.
Okay, please, Mr. Negrescu.
Okay, so I think the first thing is to actually learn something from this experience and to adapt our educational systems for, of course, and come up with solutions that will enable us, of course, to deal with the pandemic right now and, of course, a new wave or the new wave, potential waves. This is why we mentioned that explicitly in our report in the European Parliament. So 93% of members of the European Parliament consider our report as being a key document providing adequate solutions to do that. The first idea is to have a strategy. Second idea is to invest European funds adequately and also come up with national resources for that. The third thing is to, of course, work with the stakeholders in the field. Engage teachers, engage students, engage parents, engage local authorities, engage NGOs and social partners in the process. And of course, also take on board the available solutions existing at European level that succeeded. But also, why not upgrade the project implemented by local NGOs and professors at national and European level? One of the biggest issues is, of course, to tackle this issue of access. This is why I have initiated last year a pilot project supporting a better access to digital infrastructure for schools in rural and mountain areas, and we're working on the Commission on that. And of course, in the same time, we have to have proper tools. So at the beginning of last year, we showed decision maker the difference between a simple tablet and an educational tablet. So we built from scratch the first Romanian educational tablet, providing a secure environment for kids and offering them access to more than 100 educational apps evaluated by professors before. So we think the solutions are there, but we have to act responsibly. We have to make sure no one is left behind. We have to think about vulnerable groups, about kids with disabilities. We have to speak about technological schools. We have to speak about universities, and students are not going to classes for more than 1 year in Romania. And of course, we have to speak about the gender gap. There are many issues to be tackled, and for that, we need an integrated approach, an holistic approach, like Mr. Dimitrov has mentioned very well, and you mentioned as well. And of course, really, let's say, start acting. The time is now to do things. We cannot wait anymore. And of course, any delays cost us a lot in terms of, let's say, educational level at European level and at Romanian level. And of course, for that, I'm certain that everyone is willing to work constructively. So this would be my last call. Let's work constructively on that without taking into consideration our different political views, without taking into consideration that some are acting at European level, some at national, some at local level. We have to unite our energies because the future of education, the future of the European societies depends on what we are doing right now in order to foster education and improve access also to digital education.
Mr. Dimitrov, this pandemic year, what has it taught us?
I have to say that I very much agree with what Mr. Negrescu just said. These are really very important conclusions here, Mr. Negrescu. So we have learned that we are not as good as we thought. This goes in the question of capacity, teacher skills, without generalizing here, but we have seen huge gaps. The question of infrastructure, access, Mr. Negrescu mentioned it. So we really learned that we are perhaps not as good as we thought. And this goes even for some very advanced parts of the European Union. And this is a very important realization, which we have to really now embed in what we do next. We also learned that digital education is not something that is a vertical responsibility of just the education, if you like, sector, and then of no one else. No, it needs to include finance, infrastructure. It needs to include the sector. It needs to include a number of stakeholders, because effective digital education is the future. And this is something that we will have to get right if we are to have a better future, especially if we come out from the crisis in a stronger form. And we cannot all ever only outsource it to, you know, one part of the, if you like, the government. We need to really see a whole government approach. This needs to be a priority for a government, because it is about the transformation of the society, and education is really fundamental if we are to master it. And I think my last point is similar to what Mr. Negrescu said. Having presented here briefly the Digital Education Action Plan, I would say that we need, in fact, to act, and we have to implement, and we have to focus on the execution of what we have put forward. We have strategies, we have all kinds of documents and different, but we need to join forces together, also at the EU level, very important, with the European Parliament, also with the Council, and we need to act. And indeed, the time, Mr. Negrescu, I agree with you, is now. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your intervention in our Meet Your Map debate. And I hope we've learned our lessons from this pandemic year, and we'll apply our lessons in the future in our post-pandemic period as well. Thank you very much. Thank you.